These desert fathers, he himself was a Trappist monk, considered at one time in his life to be a hermit. He collected a lot of their sayings into a book, and he made it available to us so that we could get a sense of what was on the mind and the hearts of these desert fathers. One of them, known as the Abbot Pastor, would receive lots of questions and often approached for advice by the other desert fathers, the monks who had followed him into the solitude of the monastery. And they're collected, and this is one that I want to share with you this morning. Short lesson from Abbot Pastor, who was approached by one seeking wisdom. And he said, so recorded, "If you have a chest full of clothing," we all have chests full of clothing somewhere, more than we need probably. But the desert father said, "If you have a chest full of clothing and leave it for a long time, the clothing will rot inside it." You know, that will happen if we do it long enough. "It is the same," says the Abbot Father, "it is the same with the thoughts of our heart. If we do not carry them out by physical action, after a long time, they will spoil and turn bad. They will spoil and turn bad." A sixth grade boy longed to have a pair of these fancy boots. It's back in the 60s when a lot of the young boys were trying to mimic the Beatles. They wanted those sharp-toed, high-heeled boots. And so this young boy had longed for those boots. He saw the other boys wearing them, and he desperately wanted to be like those other boys who were mirroring the Beatles. The problem was, this young boy didn't have the money to buy the boots, and even more complicated was, if he did have the money, his parents would not allow him to have the boots. So one day in school, the boy shared with one of the kids who had these boots how much he really liked those boots and how he would love someday to own a pair of the boots himself. The boy, who was listening to the longings of his friend, offered to get him a pair of the boots. The boy knew that this would not happen, because there'd be an exchange of money. The boy who longed for the boots and the boy who offered to get the boots, they both knew that the boots would be stolen from the store. And sure enough, a few days later, back at school, the boots arrived in the hands of the boy who stole the boots. And he handed them over to this little boy who had so desperately wanted these shoes. And filled with excitement, he thanked the young thief and took the boots home and hid them in his room. It was that same night that he tried on the boots. They fit perfectly. They gave the young boy the exact look that he wanted. He just looked down at them, and he tried them on with all different kinds of pants, and he was just so happy that he now had these boots and he could be that same image. He took the boots off, placed them in a hiding place in his room, and got ready for bed. And as he lay down that night, with what he thought would be a restful night, the excitement of having those boots turned into dread. The thoughts of his heart started to keep him awake and started to agitate him. Anxiety just grew and grew and grew, and thinking of the stolen boots made him so anxious, and the weight of guilt increased so much that with every passing hour, he could feel himself getting sick. He felt his stomach churning. And finally, he rose up from bed, and he grabbed the boots from the hiding place, and tearfully made his way downstairs to the living room where his mother was sitting. Unsure of what was wrong, she asked her son, "Why are you crying? And what do you have in your hands?" He showed his mother what he was holding, the stolen boots. And he cried and he said, I'm sorry that I have these boots. I got them in the wrong way, and I know that you didn't want me to have these boots." And he just poured out his heart. He sat there with his mother and they talked about this situation. And they agreed that the boots needed to go back where they came from. And so the next day, he took them to school and he told that boy who had taken them out of the store that, "You need to take them back. I can't accept them. You need to return them as they were stolen." And so after unpacking his guilt over the stolen boots, that same night he was able to go back to bed. He was able to lay his head down and to rest, and he felt so much better now that the bonds of guilt were lifted. He was free to sleep knowing that he had a plan to return the boots. But more importantly, he had learned a lesson. That the burdens that he carried in his heart, even at that young age, could be released. That if he would learn how to physically move that thought of his heart that was troubling him, and to share it with someone else, in this case, his mother, that he could learn and experience that great gift from God that we call grace. The short story of the boy overwhelmed by the weight of guilt echoes the wisdom of Abbot Pastor. "The thoughts," says Abbot Pastor, "of your heart can spoil and turn bad." We all know that. Our own life experience. That things that we hold within ourselves, in our hearts, and in our gut, over time, if they are not addressed, things that have that element of shadow, that element of pain, that element of guilt, that element of regret, that element, whatever it may be, that sits in the heart, it sits in the mind, and sits in the gut, if they're not addressed, if they're not moved, they can rot and spoil over time. Our gospel lesson story of the resurrection of Lazarus provides us with the living symbol of new life in Christ. It gives us this image of a man who was formerly dead but still bound by cloth that is used to bind up the body of a deceased person. It gives us the idea that there is not only things that restrict us in death, even death while we're still living, but there's also this great power that can give us the freedom and grace that we need. Empty of life, the body of Lazarus was prepared and buried before Jesus could even arrive. And warned by Martha, after he did arrive with the 4-day stench of death, Jesus stood by waiting for this tombstone to be removed. Jesus was not afraid of approaching that tombstone and even going in if he needed to. And Jesus at the same time reminds Martha what he had taught her earlier about faith. That even in the face of death, that if you believe, you will see the glory of God, Martha. That you can stand in front of the powers of death and still expect to see the glories of God. You see, Martha too was bound by the powers of death. She and her sister Mary lamented so much that Jesus had not arrived sooner to prevent Lazarus' death. And the scripture tells us, the gospel lesson reveals to us that Jesus was, yes, distressed over the loss of the life of a friend. But I don't believe he was distressed over the fact that he knew that there was a power greater than death. Now came the time for Jesus to reveal God's saving grace and victory over the power Now came the time for Jesus to reveal God's promise of new life, revealed through him, that would be made visible for all to see. It was right there at that time, as the gospel writer John creates this image for us to see and to experience with our own eyes, and to bring into our heart, into the thoughts of our mind and heart, the power of God's grace through Jesus. You see, there'd be no holding back the promise of salvation for Jesus in this very moment. He was going to enter into that, the darkness, into the stench of death, and to reveal to those that were there the power of new life through him. There would be no more burdens from the weight of death. New life was available. Author Larry Crabb, in his book titled Connecting, writes this about communities and people. Those of us that live together and all of us together, he makes this observation about ourselves. He says, our communities, church communities, wider community, he says, our communities are filled with people desperate to unburden themselves in the presence of another. Our communities have people that are longing to be known at a level where the only antidote to disdain is grace. Just like that young boy that had to unload the anxiety and disdain that he had for himself and for all that he felt holding on to those stolen boots. He had to go and physically unload those boots before his mother and physically unload what was deep within his heart that was just taking him away into darker and darker places. And we too, all of us, our communities, we need to have that place where we can receive the grace of God. And we have to have that in the presence of another. We have to have that place be a trusting place where we can encounter others and be truly human and be able to say to others, knowing that we'll be listened to and loved and cared for. Crabb goes on to say is that we need to be known at a level where the only antidote to disdain is grace. We need to know that we can sink beneath death's dark waters while in the grip of strong hands that promise to raise us up into the newness of life. Brothers and sisters, Christians are called to be people who both know the power of untying and letting go the bonds of death. We, as individuals, are called to be those people who know and believe in the power of that very hymn that you sang with the choir and sang on your own, that soon and soon, and very soon, we will see the glory of God and the power of that goes beyond any bonds of death. Christians are called to be the people who can go into communities and know the power of untying and letting go of the bonds of death, letting go of the weight of guilt and anxiety that comes with sin. We're hearing today that prisons are overloaded and that there are countless young men and some women who are in prison that shouldn't be there. But there they are in this place where they're carrying this anxiety and this understanding of civic or community disdain, for they are now marked for having been incarcerated. But brothers and sisters, they're coming back. Some being released early because there's no room left and there's no need for them to be there, and some having finished their time, but they need to know that when they come into a community, that they're coming into a community that longs for them to be able to let go of anything that had bound them up and gave them the understanding that they are less than who they can be. And the church has to be that place. The church has to be that place that will reach out and say, brother or sister, you are loved and you can change and you can let go and untie those bonds that have you trapped and thinking that you are not worthy of God's love and mercy. Christians are called to be the people who know the power of untying and letting go of the bonds of death, letting go of the weight of guilt and anxiety that comes with sin. And Bishop Shelby Spong writes about this when he reflects on the story of Lazarus. He points out how the religious leaders opposed Jesus, and they saw his new life ministry as a threat to what they believed about God. They thought that Jesus was a threat to their identity as the chosen people of God. But what Bishop Spong sees in this limited view of God by these religious leaders is a limit on the humanity. A limit on humanity that binds up our potential. And that's what I'm talking about in terms of our young people returning into the community after being incarcerated. The church has to be very vocal and very present and very alive in saying, your worst day of your life is not the sum total of your life. Is that true? The worst day of our lives is not the sum total of our lives.
No.
And that, if that was the case, we would all be condemned.
Yes. Yes.
Because we all have had bad days.
Yes.
Days where we just don't understand where we came from or whatever we said or did. But that is not the sum total of our lives. You see, we have this great potential. As God's people. And our potential is not only to grow and to change and to transform into what God wills us to be, but also to accompany others who have lost sight of their potential. And that's what troubles me. Is that oftentimes the church, the community, will stand by idle and not be that place where those that are desperate to unburden themselves can go and say, yes, I have made a mistake, but now I need to be embraced, I need to be guided, I need to be mentored into a new place. And if the church does not stand for a place to be new, then what do we stand for? Because we are the product of a Lord and of a Savior who says, you can be something new. You can be the transforming love of God. You can be the light of the world. Failing to believe in the power of Easter, failing to believe in the power of resurrection when the boundaries of death were torn down, is a failure to experience God's promise of new life. And so when we encounter one another, when we encounter the neighbor who's re-entering the community from whatever incarceration, we encounter ourselves in that place. We have to remember that we are Easter people.
Amen.
And that there is always a new day, a new opportunity, no matter how smelly and how rotten it is. That stone can be rolled away and there's a Lord who will reach out to you and say, you are a beloved one. And you can start again.
Amen.
You can untie the binds. You can let go of all that cloth that had you wrapped up as good as dead and know that you are an Easter child.
Yes.
Ready to go on anew. And when we allow those bonds to stay there, when we condemn others for what they did, and yes, again and again I say you must pay whatever civil penalty that is due, but you will never, ever forfeit your humanity and your name as a child of God.
Amen.
Never! I don't care what you have done. You will always be a sacred child of God. And the bonds of death, the bonds and the power of Satan can be broken and can be put aside, and you can hear the call of Jesus. Let him go. Let him go into the world. Let him go and be something new, a beloved child of God. You know, saints are not perfect people.
No.
No. Saints are far from perfect. What saints are those who are not bound by their human limitations. They understand, a saint understands that his or her worst day in their lives is not the sum total of their life. Saints are willing to give voice to their wrongdoings, to the thoughts of their hearts. They're willing to be open to through the grace of God that is experienced through those who prayerfully listen and trust that God will intervene in conversation. Saints know that even that worst day is not the sum total of life. Saints believe in the power of Christ's love. Saints know a power that allows them to untie the bonds of sin and to move freely forward in eternal life. That's what a saint is. A saint is not a perfect person. A saint is a person who knows perfect love. A saint is one who knows grace. A saint is one who is willing to share what he or she's experienced in that perfect love and is being willing to introduce someone to that gift of grace. Sisters and brothers in Christ, is there something hidden in your room? Are you hiding something under your bed? Closet? Are you hiding something in the rafters that needs to be brought out into the light? Are there burdens that you want to unload in exchange for the antidote of grace? Brothers and sisters, is there something within you that needs to be untied so that you'll have the freedom to move forward in faith? Oh, yeah. Friends in Christ, are you anxious? Are you anxious with what you hold within your heart? But is there this other anxiety that comes with being anxious about the light? About the light that shines, and you know it's there, that if you're just willing to open up that space and to take that physical choice to move forward that which is in your heart into the open, are you anxious to experience the newness of life that comes with believing? Believing that once you make that choice to open up your heart and mind, that God will fill that space with life, with love, with grace. That you won't be left out there dangling, having opened up everything and admitted and confessed and whatever it may have been in a relationship and whatever that situation is. But don't worry, God's not going to leave you out there dangling. God's going to embrace you and fill you with the healing power of grace. Are you like me, longing to experience God's glory? And friends, in closing, I just say to you, if you answered yes to any of these questions, I just long that you know that the light of life is freely available. Freely available. The light of new life is so free, given to us out of sacrificial love. I pray that you will not be afraid to whatever that burden that you're carrying, don't be afraid to lay it down. Don't be afraid to bring it right to this altar when you come for communion. If you want to lay it down before you receive the elements, this communion rail is here for you. You can come. Lay down your burden right here. If you need prayer, pray for yourself. You ask someone to pray for you. You don't have to lay out that burden verbally, vocally. You just let it out from your heart and know that you will receive grace. That when you come to receive these elements, that you have come with that space open, wide open for God to fill. The sacrificial gifts of love, the simple bread and the simple cup. Brothers and sisters, be not afraid to set your burdens down. Be not afraid to empty out what holds you back. And be not afraid to open your hearts to the grace of God. Untie, and let yourself go.
Amen.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, let us prepare then for this meal. For this holy meal that Jesus himself has prepared for us. And so I invite you to turn to your hymnals, to the screen, as we pray this prayer of confession. And hear these words of invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, willing to be untied and to go forward, and to seek and live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. I invite you to join in the prayer of confession found on page 12 in your hymn. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the bleeding. Forgive us, we pray.